Today we're gonna try to do something a little different. But first, I do that every week. I do that every week. But part of it is because I think we get into a rut of routine, and we make routine an idol. And when we get into a routine of something, we get comfortable, and we make that the norm, and that becomes a religious spirit often. And I think we need to continue to seek new ways to break out of things that are so routine. And I know that's uncomfortable for most of us, but I think that's the very way of the Spirit. It always removes control away from us into places in the hands of God. And that's uncomfortable for most of us, but I think that is what God is calling us to do, is to walk in faith step by step. And so, yeah, I say we try something new every week. Well, because I think I am trying. trying new things. But one of the things that I really want to share with you today is about how God is speaking to this particular church and this body about the end times. And I really believe that God is highlighting the end times and getting us to prepare ourselves and to position ourselves in such a way to be used by God for the last days. And I hear that so clearly again and again. And you know, my heart begins to get excited, but also my heart begins to yearn to see my Lord. I can't wait to see him. And the Lord says in Matthew 24:13. It says that in the end, last days, how we shall know is the last days is the heart of the people will grow cold. And we'll see the hearts of the people getting darker. And the darkness is not so much outside world. I think if we start looking for the darkness that comes externally, I think that would be misplaced. It's a misdirection. I think we need to begin to look at the darkness that's internal that begins to spread externally, where people's heart begins to turn towards themselves rather than towards God and to each other. And this darkness is something that becomes absolute until we stop caring altogether about anybody else but ourselves. And we feel that's the sign of the end times, that what we see all around us is a very clear sign that we're really close, aren't we? That people's hearts are so focused on my desires and what I want and what I need. It's all about me. And this is what Scripture tells us in Matthew 24:13. This is a sure sign that end is really, really close. And if we ask the question to all those people who are outside the church, how close are we in terms of how close is your heart towards anybody else but your own desire? How much are you willing to sacrifice and lay down something for somebody else? And the answer becomes, wow, we're really close, right? But I think God, during the end times, doesn't only set apart the darkness, but the light also becomes lighter. And as there's darkness, as the heart gets cold, there's a remnant whose heart becomes inflamed by the passion of God. To the degree which the heart grows cold, there's another group whose heart grows that much more fonder for the things of God and things of others. And I believe God is calling this particular ministry called Harvesters to that kind of vision of community and life and love of God. Because I think God is preparing us for something great. And God is about to launch us into something that we haven't even imagined. And I began to say, like when we began to see the hand of God moving the pieces on the chessboard, you begin to wonder, wow, this is amazing. But I think the chessboard is getting really, really, really big. And I'll share with you as things develop, but things are in the works where we are beginning to see maybe God's really positioning us for something really large. We say, I remember I go back to this illusion a lot because Brian asked me a year ago, he said, Arnold, really, we have 20 people here. Is this going to change the world? I said, Brian, absolutely. If God so desires it, absolutely. And we are beginning to see something different. God's been pouring something so incredible over this house week in and week out. And every week I'm thinking, can it get better than this? And each week I feel like God takes us into another level. the air is getting really thin up here. And it's been pretty amazing. But I believe that God is calling this house because for many of us, the reason is because we know the love of God firsthand. And I could look around this room and see so many faces where I remember when each of those faces were in tears because the love of God had touched on their hearts. I remember Brian standing in front of a speaker at a retreat, just losing himself by the love of God is being wrecked. I remember when Paul first experienced the love of God on his knees, just crying, weeping and wailing. I remember Isaac walking into our little town on first day and just being Isaac, and it was amazing. And I remember so many, Adrian in that corner right here, just being touched by God and sliding off the wall. Because I remember those moments. We know the love and the touch of God. We have felt it. We lived it. It's such a pure love, and it's transformed us, hasn't it? And this is why I believe that God is calling this community. And I remember this past Friday, and I was talking to Natalie, which we text a lot, and Natalie was saying that this was a really good service. And, you know, I wasn't satisfied with the service on Friday night. And I said, Natalie, you know, it's okay. It was good. It was good introduction for a lot of people. We just experienced a lot of prophecy and people being with so much accuracy. It was amazing. And I just, you know, but I was like, I just didn't have that kind of like, you know, like it just didn't have that feel of just overwhelming sense of just being knocked out by the power of God. And I was texting her and saying how I would love to see when people walk in, the power of God will come on them and people just fall over at the doorsteps, you know, and they will know the power of God. But Natalie said, you know, Pastor Arnold, you know, that's not necessarily how God works. And she said sometimes it's in the quiet, small voice. And it's that love that transforms us, and we have that love. And we could testify to it by many people's lives that it's been transformed by this community. And I said, you're right, Natalie. You're right. I'm sorry. You're right. And I love it when we correct one another in that way. It's beautiful because we know we're growing in our understanding of God. And so that's right. And I believe that God would have us be launched into something great. And I believe it, but there's a warning in my spirit. There's a deep warning in my spirit that speaks, that there's echoes Revelation chapter 2. When Jesus is speaking to the church of Ephesus, it is a powerful church. For 40 years, they've been running hard. And Jesus says, you've been so faithful. You work so hard and so diligently. You hate sin. You don't tolerate it in your community. You don't tolerate false doctrine. You work so hard and you're spreading the gospel to Asia Minor. I'm so proud of you. But I have this one thing against you. This one thing, he says, is that you have forgotten your first love. You do not love me like you used to. You do not love one another like you used to. And we see in Church of Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15, it tells us it was the Church of Ephesus was a church that was famous for the way it loved all churches. But the love of Ephesus had grown cold for whatever reason. And I hear that warning in my spirit. I hear this warning of the spirit saying to this body, saying, be careful. Because if we look at the church of Ephesus, how can God say that? When the church was spreading the gospel to the ends of the earth, the gospel is going forth from Asia Minor to the ends of the earth. Jesus, what are you doing? If you take the lampstand, how shall the great commission be fulfilled? But Jesus says this, I am the Lord of the harvest, and I will determine the quality of heart that is spread across the earth. And the quality of heart that he desires to spread and reproduce in the earth is the quality of love. A heart that has been ravished by the love of God. A heart that's been so pierced by that love. And God's been pouring and pouring and pouring. We have seen things that people shouldn't see. I mean, we people are seeing heavens and they're seeing the tree of life. And we know what the tree of life looks like, guys. You know, Megan saw it. It's in a heart shape. And the fruit changes color every time you look at it. It's amazing. People in this house are seeing things and experiencing things because the heaven is opening up and blessing us. It's been incredible. It's been so amazing. But what God is saying to us, I really believe, is that we cannot be satisfied with those experiences. If we are satisfied with those experiences and walk away from those experiences as if that experience in itself determines your relationship with God, then quality of our heart will begin to grow cold. What I mean is this, and Paul said this well. He said, you know, these experiences of God, that we encounter with God, it's like going on a date with God. God, you know, we bring, in a Valentine's Day, we remember those little candy hearts that's really cheap, like really nasty sugar rocks in a shape of a heart that says, be mine, Valentine, whatever, right? And the E scratched off because it's not really printed right. Be my Valentine, right? So when we bring something like that to God and, you know, we take it out of our pocket and with the lint and everything, we say, oh, God, this is what I have for you. And God takes that, and in place, God gives you this, a heart size of a moon, and said, this is how much I love you. I'm so pleased with you. It's incredible. How do we deserve that love? And for far too many of us, we go on this date with God where our heart is so alive. Right now, many of us, our hearts are alive because the worship was good. God was pouring out his grace upon you, and our hearts are alive. But when we go back, as soon as we walk out the, I mean, maybe the service is over, then we check out and we don't reflect and process that experience of that date and love of God. Once we start doing that, what happens is then your mind begins to disengage. What God wants from us, as James 1 tells us, is that when the word of God is spoken, when the word of God says, I love you, I love you. He wants us to take that word and begin to reflect upon it and begin to obey it. And in as we meditate upon the lingering that aroma of that date with God, what happens is our heart begins to grow fonder for him, and we're able to respond to him, look forward to greater and greater engagement and intimacy with him. And in that allows for us to be able to grow in our passion and love for our beloved. But for far too many of us, we consume it and walk away from it as if that was sufficient. And I'm telling you, that is not sufficient. And for far too many of us, I think we consume these experiences of dates with God, an encounter of love with God, as just chuck it off another experience. But I'm telling you, God tells us that the discipleship, what it means to be follower of Jesus, begins not when you pray the sinner's prayer, begins when you are willing to give up your life and follow him. And you can't do that unless your heart is so ravished by his love. And the question I want to ask all of us, and I want us to break off into groups and actually discuss it, and that's a little weird in a service, but I want us to do that. I want us to have a define the relationship conversation. Right? Do you know what I mean? We need to check our hearts and say, where are we with Jesus? Are we ready to really make that kind of commitment to him that he requires? For his love is jealous. He desires no other. He hates competition. He wants to destroy it. And he wants to ask you that question today. Where are you? Where's your heart? Because if our heart is just simply in consuming and coming and feeling like, well, I did my checkoff on Sunday, that's nothing. That's even worse than nothing. That Christianity is not Christianity at all. But you're a crowd. But Jesus calls us to be disciples. And only disciples can be made when we are in love with him. So I'm going to invite you right now to have the conversation, that awkward conversation. Let's define the relationship with Jesus. So I want us to break up into groups of four, okay, right now. And just discuss where you are in your journey with Jesus. Groups of four. Right here, four right here. Sharon. And then maybe Kenson. Yes, Kenson. And then it's Sharon and you. Okay. You get five right there. Okay. You get five. We could do five. Jesse, can we get some music? Give me some music. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, tell us where you are, what things that is hindering you from really going further in the relationship. Tell us where you are. Talk to each other about where you are in your relationship with God. And begin to define the areas that hinder you from going further. Why you aren't able to make a greater commitment to Christ. And so there's the Knutson family. So Knutson family. Sorry. Yeah. Oh, you could be here. But yeah.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. And your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come fly. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Couple more minutes. I hate to cut this short. I know this great conversation is going, but I want to invite us to just come back and I want to start to wrap this up. Somebody to turn down the music real quick. Just the music, yeah. Great. It looks like we had a great conversation. Amen. I hope it brought some clarity to your own heart and thinking. And I pray that that's the purpose of this exercise. But the idea is that the revelation of God's love cannot be given without intimacy. As we go from intimacy to intimacy, there's greater revelation. But if we go from the service and we go back home and we begin to meditate upon what God is doing, God is saying, and we began to act upon that, our hearts grow fonder throughout the week. It gets cultivated more and more and more. And as we think more about God and as God speaks to more to us in each of those moments, I think what happens is our heart begins to grow fonder and anticipation grows for encounter with Him more and more. And when the experience, actually when the worship time comes, what it is an explosion of the encounter with our God yet again. And in that moment, you can pour out yourself. But if we do it the opposite way, we wait upon the encounter, the worship service to feed us, then we'll never grow. We'll always be stagnant, and then we'll stay in the status quo. Does that make sense? And what somebody told me yesterday was that God's love is like a deep ocean. There's just no end to the love of God. And God wants to show us the wonders and the beauty and the majesty of the work that He's done in that ocean. He wants to take you deep and show you things you never thought possible and take you deeper and show you the wonders of creation, wonders of His heart for you and the world. But for far too many of us, way that we practice intimacy, we stay at the shore playing sandcastle, and we are satisfied with the foam of the crashing waves and the aftermath of the love of God and simply be satisfied with that because that's a safe thing. But God is calling us deeper into His love. He's taking us far, far deeper. He wants us to go so deep, you don't know. If you go so deep in the water, you don't know where up is and down is anymore, right? And that's where how far he wants to take us. He wants to disorient us in his love. He wants us to get so lost in his love, we don't know what is up, what is down anymore. But for far too many of us, we're saying, no, this is enough. I'm satisfied here. But God is saying, will you not come deeper? Will you not take another step? But because we are afraid of what this may mean, we may are afraid of losing control in the waves of love of God that we refuse and we stand back in the shores and we just simply play with the foams. But what God is saying, won't you come deeper into my love? Will you not go deeper? Because it's not enough. No, go around. It's not enough. So I want to challenge us today. Wherever you were in your defining the relationship, now you know, hopefully better, articulated. Was it more clear when you spoke it out? Okay. All right. And I want us to begin to think about what does it mean to go deeper? It means spending intimate time with the Lord. And two things are necessary. Matthew 7, 22 to 24 tells us this. Nope, sorry, 24 to 27. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because its foundation was on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who builds his house on a sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell with a great crash. Brothers and sisters, unless we practice what we hear today and begin to exercise that intimacy and obedience, what happens is that our house is only built on the sand. So it begins to shift with every situation and circumstance. But if we begin to build an obedience and intimacy, what happens is your foundation of love becomes so strong. Doesn't matter what circumstances and who comes, doesn't matter what comes your way, you'll be able to stand firm in the love of God. Amen. So we want us to invite the praise band, and we're going to have time of ministry where we're just going to take care of some business with the Lord tonight, or today, or this afternoon. Okay, if you, it's been, amen.
Lord, that your yoke is easy and your burden light, Lord. And that we don't have to work towards you, but worship towards you, Lord. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that as we spend time in your presence, Lord, that you are, Lord, that you are drilling deep wells, Lord, of living water, Lord, in our souls. Dear Lord, thank you so much for your grace. Lord, I can't even really comprehend, Lord. Lord, you know how much I struggle with pride, Lord, but I can still call on your name, Lord. And you'll meet me, Lord. You'll come to me. So, Lord, I just thank you for your grace. For your mercy, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Can we just give each other a hug? Hey, that's how we end. Amen. Praise the Lord.